بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ما بعد. So alhamdulillah, after finishing the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a total of 105 episodes, alhamdulillah, we did. Now I have a slight change of heart. I had initially announced we're going to do the mothers of the believers. We will still do that, but we will begin with the lives of the famous Sahaba, and we'll work our way to the mothers of the believers. So this is going to be our new series for the foreseeable future. And we will start with obviously Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and then work our way to the other famous Sahaba. Now I want to make a very important disclaimer here. This is not a series about the history of the Khulafaa. Rather, this is a series about the Sahaba. So we will talk about the Khulafaa, obviously in order, but the goal is not to talk about their reign and era. Rather, the goal is to talk about them in an entire biography, and of course we'll have to mention some things about their eras. But it is not a comprehensive history of the Khulafa al-Rashidun. Rather, it is a summary of the biographies of these four great Sahaba, and then other Sahaba after them. And we will continue talking about various Sahaba, and then we will also talk about the mothers of the believers. So this will be a series about introducing us to the lives of the greatest men and women who walked on the face of this earth after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is of course his Sahaba. And I have mentioned before, and I will mention explicitly now, and by the way, the allergy season is beginning, so you will notice this. Where is the tissue box? Is there a tissue box? Can you, because the, unfortunately I didn't take my allergy medicine today. As I said, one of the reasons I'm hesitant to talk about the lives of the Khulafa al-Rashidun as a history of the Khulafa al-Rashidun is because there are issues that take place, Jazakallah khair, in the lives of the Khulafa. There are issues that take place in the era of the Khulafa that are problematic. And most problematic amongst them is the civil war. The civil wars that took place, the assassination of Uthman opened this door of fighting between the Muslims and some of the people that we look up to, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Aisha radiallahu anhum, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, they're all going to war. And it is perhaps safer for us not to resurrect these past controversies, because there's very little to be gained for the average Muslim. Only the specialist who wants to specialize in history, they will benefit. For the most of us, the methodology of Sunni Islam, in contrast to other versions of Islam who love to talk about those controversies all the time, Sunni Islam, we don't like to mention these past controversies because it makes the heart hard. It makes, there's no benefit. What happened, happened. Talking about it now is not going to change anything. And as Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala said when he was asked about this controversy, he said, that was a time Allah saved us from participating with our hands, so why don't we as well save ourselves from participating with our tongues? Allah blessed us, we weren't around to physically take part, so alhamdulillah, we didn't have to choose sides. We did not have to choose sides. Imagine, yani, what a fitna it was that you have Aisha on one side, you have Ali on the other side, you have so many of the Sahaba themselves divided. So we don't want to talk about that controversy. We want to gloss over it. Because of this, I don't think it is appropriate or wise to talk about in detail the era of the Khulafa al-Rashidun. And also, I do not know of any person who has attempted to, especially in modern times, have any series about this issue, except that he has gotten into major controversies from the scholars of the world, because you're never going to say something that's going to please everybody. You're going to say things that will go this way or that way, and I just don't see the point. Not that, as you know, I'm a very frank and blunt person and I speak my mind, but in this case, I don't see the point. Let it be. What happened, happened. Let's move on. So, with that disclaimer, because I don't want somebody to come and say, after they listen to the series, oh, you didn't talk about this, you didn't talk about that. Yes, I didn't put the condition on myself to be comprehensive. So with that disclaimer, let us begin with the greatest of the Sahaba, and that is Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And inshallah, by the end of today, and this is part one of Abu Bakr, we'll continue next week, we will realize how dismally ignorant we are, how little we know really. We think we know, But wallahi, we know so little. And this, the reason therefore for these types of seminars is to gain some basic knowledge about some of these great individuals. If I were to ask you, what is the name of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq? What is the name of the greatest Sahabi who ever lived? Then who amongst you would be able to tell me his name? Simply his name. Because obviously his name is not Siddiq, and Abu Bakr is a laqab or a title. What is his name? Abu Qahafa is his father. Google it. His name is Google it. His name is Abdullah ibn Uthman ibn Amir ibn Amr ibn Ka'b ibn Sa'ad ibn Taym ibn Murra ibn Ka'b ibn Lu'ay. So Abdullah ibn Uthman is his name. Abdullah ibn Uthman. And he meets with the Prophet ﷺ in the sixth grandfather. In the sixth grandfather, and that is Ka'b ibn Lu'ay. So the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr, they go back six generations to the same person. Because obviously Abu Bakr is Qurashi. And his sub-tribe is what? Banu Taym. Banu Taym. Quraysh, the sub-tribe Banu Taym. Banu Taym was not of the big names of the Quraysh. You know, the big names were the Banu Umayyah, the Banu Abd al-Dar, the Banu Hashim. These were the big names. The Banu Maghzum, which Abu Jahl was from, these were the big ones. As for the Banu Taym's, and then Umar ibn al-Khattab's is the Banu Adi, Uthman is the Banu Umayyah, Ali is of course Banu Hashim, right? So all of these names, you should know them, the sub-tribes of the Quraysh. Now it is said that Abu Bakr was born with the name Abdul Ka'ba. His father called him Abdul Ka'ba, but when he embraced Islam, the Prophet ﷺ changed it to Abdullah. So his name is Abdullah ibn Uthman. So Abu Bakr therefore is a laqab, it is a nickname that is given to him, and it appears that this nickname was given to him by his father. So it was common for a father to nickname the son. This is not his kunya, because he did not have a son called Bakr. This was simply a title, a nickname that his father gave him, and he was known even in Jahiliyyah as Abu Bakr. So his father used to call him Abu Bakr. And what does Bakr mean? Bakr is the young, energetic camel. And of course, this is like the sign of the, you know, Arabs. This is the young male camel is called a Bakr. And that's from the phrase, the Arabs know, ala bakrati abihim. That's where it comes from. So it's a young male camel. So Abu Bakr kind of means the one who has all of these camels, the one who can control this camel. That's the meaning of Abu Bakr. And the name Bakr was also common, and it is still common, not that common, but still there are people that call themselves, you know, Bakr is a common name, and the meaning therefore is a young, powerful male camel. So Abu Bakr, as I said, indicates that he is going to be wealthy, have lots of camels, control the camels, is basically the one who controls these young camels. This is the title or the nickname, the pet name that his father gave him, and this name was the name that stuck in Jahiliyyah and in Islam. And his father, of course, all of you, one of you already said, he also had a title, and that is Abu Quhafa. Abu Quhafa. And Abu Quhafa, his name was Uthman. So Abdullah ibn Uthman. His name, his title, or his laqab, if you like, was Abu Quhafa. And Abu Quhafa, Quhafa with a dhamma. And some people say Qahafa, but it is Quhafa. Abu Quhafa. Abu Quhafa, when did he accept Islam? Remind me. Conquest of Mecca. He accepted Islam at the conquest of Mecca. And while in the Meccan phase and in the Medinan phase, he clearly was not a Muslim. And he does have phrases of harshness. He doesn't appear to have been of the blatant enemies of Islam, like Umayyah or like even Abu Sufyan before he converted. He seems to be a minor. He has some harsh words. If you remember in the story of the Hijrah, Abu Quhafa got irritated at Asma, his granddaughter, when he found out that Abu Bakr had taken all of the money and Asma was hiding this from him. He slapped Asma across the face, and he said bad things about the Prophet and Abu Bakr. So he was angry, but this is not, and I'm not defending his, he was a kafir at the time, but this is an anger that his son hasn't left money for the family. Nonetheless, he did have some negative statements about the Prophet, but his animosity was not that open or that harsh as was the animosity of others of the Quraysh. And he did in fact accept Islam. And of course the story of his Islam is well known, that he accepted Islam at a very late age. Probably he was 90 years old at the time. And so he's half blind and he cannot walk. So he was carried on a stretcher, if you like, or on a, in fact a shield. They say he was put on a shield and he was carried to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the conquest of Mecca. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that famous phrase, هَلَّا تَرَكْتَ بِالشَّيْخِ فِي الْبَيْتِ, why didn't you leave the Shaykh, the old man at home? We would have come to him. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, no, it is more befitting that he should come to you. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for him, tapped him on his heart, and you know, aslim tuslim, he said, accept Islam, Allah will be merciful to you. So he accepted Islam after all of those years at the age of 90. And the Prophet congratulated Abu Bakr that your father has embraced Islam. And as I said, at the time Abu Bakr began crying and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I would willingly give this up if Abu Talib were here. Because he knew the love of the Prophet for Abu Talib. Because I wish Abu Talib were here instead of my own father. That's how much, you know, love he had for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And of course at this conversion story as well, he said the famous hadith that is in Bukhari and Muslim, is the famous fiqh hadith that Abu Quhafa, his hair was pigeon white. That's what the hadith is, complete white. Everything around him was white. So the Prophet told the women of the household, go and change this and dye it some color, but avoid pure black. So from this we get the sunnah that the one who has completely white hair should have some type of dye. And this is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So the father of Abu Bakr is Abu Quhafa. The mother of Abu Bakr is Salma binti Sakhr. Salma binti Sakhr. And his mother accepted Islam very early on, unlike the father. So the mother accepted Islam from the very beginning. One of the first female converts in the early Meccan stage was the mother of Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, so his mother and father basically both embraced Islam. The father later on, the mother early on. And Abu Bakr has been described by a number of eyewitnesses as having been of light complexion. The abiyad word is used. And abiyad, I've said this many times, when an Arab is described as abiyad, this does not mean what we call white, because they would call white asfar. Abiyad for the Arabs meant wheatish brown, light, light brown. So we would call it wheatish complexion. So when the Arabs say abiyad, they don't mean white, even though abiyad means white. But they considered wheatish skin, they would call it abiyad. As for white skin, they would call it yellow, asfar. He is described as being tall and extremely skinny, thin. Many, many narrations about he didn't have flesh, his thighs were small, his izar, his belt always kept on slipping, you know, his belt kept on moving down because he was a thin man, very thin person, not much flesh on his body, razor straight, always, you know, standing somewhat tall, and even his shins. So he was very bony basically, not fleshy at all, like a very thin, frail man, and tall relatively for the people of his time. And we don't know much about his early life, but we do know some things about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq that make him stand out from the crowd. Of them, which is explicitly reported in many, many incidents of the seerah and even a hadith, was that Abu Bakr was the most knowledgeable of the Sahaba regarding ilmul ansab, the science of genealogy. There is a branch of literature and a branch of knowledge and even a branch of Islamic knowledge. And one of my teachers, I remember telling me that this branch of Islamic knowledge is the least studied in all of the branches of Islamic knowledge. So much so that it is almost a forgotten science. And this is very true. It's not taught anywhere, in any university. Ilmul Ansab is not taught. You have to go study it on your own and whatnot. Ilmul Ansab basically means genealogies. And in those days, I mean, if you were to be an Arab, we went over this and we talked about what it meant to be an Arab. To be an Arab was a bloodline. It wasn't an ethnicity as much as it was a massive tribe. Every single Arab was therefore somehow related to every other Arab. Correct? Think about it, right? Every Arab would go back to either Adnan or to Qahtan, right? And every single Arab would know his lineage back to these people. So every person would know his own lineage. But who's going to interconnect? This is ilmul ansab. And included with ilmul ansab, what we would call is mu'arrikh or historian. So we call a historian, they call it ilmul ansab. So ilmul ansab is not just the nasab, the genealogy, but also what happened at each level. And the histories and the battles and the tragedies and the dramas, all of this is ilmul ansab. So this is, Abu Bakr is a historian, if you like. And it is narrated in Ibn Ishaq multiple times that whenever the Prophet ﷺ would go to give da'wah to a tribe, he would take Abu Bakr with him. And he would ask Abu Bakr, who are these people? What do I need to know about them, basically, right? And Abu Bakr would tell him, these are so-and-so, the children of so-and-so, this happened with them, these are their specialities, this is, you know, don't mention this topic. So Abu Bakr was the personal, if you like, nasab, or the genealogist or the historian of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also in the famous incident of Hassan ibn Thabit, that when the Quraysh wrote a satirical poem against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet said to Hassan, stand up and respond to this poem and Jibreel will help you. So Hassan said, Ya Rasulullah, I don't know anything about the Quraysh. I don't know what to say, what not to say. So he said, Abu Bakr, stand and go with him and tell him all he needs to know. So Abu Bakr was the one chosen that you give the facts, Hassan, you make the poem, right? So this is now teamwork, by the way, you managers here, this is teamwork, each speciality, that the guy who knows the facts, the guy who knows the how to make the poems come together and go and do your job. And Ibn Hajar also narrates that Abu Bakr was the most beloved of the Nassabun, the Ilm al-Ansab specialist of the Quraysh, because he never uttered a vulgarity or a bad thing about anybody. It was in his nature that he never mentioned that type of stuff. And he would overlook it, even in the days of Jahiliyyah. So he became beloved because everybody would only hear the good about his tribe. And kind of course, Abu Bakr knew that stuff, and when needed to, he could say it. So when Hassan needed it, he told them things. But it was not his nature to go and smear other people, which was in contrast to other genealogists who would love to smear other tribes and boost their own. Abu Bakr was a fair and neutral person. So the people loved him for this. And in fact, there's a hadith narrated in Sahih Muslim that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that inna Abu Bakr la'a'lamu an-nasi bil ansab fil Quraysh, that Abu Bakr is the most knowledgeable of the ilm al-ansab in the Quraysh. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam testified to this knowledge of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Also, of the things that we know even from before Islam is that he was of chaste, dignified, decent character. As-Suyuti, the famous historian, he mentions that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, even before coming to Islam, he never drank alcohol, he never engaged in premarital fahisha, and he never venerated an idol. And this is very rare for the pre-Islamic Arabs. Very rare. And Abu Bakr was one of those very few people that didn't do any of these things. And there's a report by Aisha radiallahu anha that she mentions her father, and she says that Abu Bakr made khamr haram on himself even before Islam. Abu Bakr made khamr haram because, she says, once Abu Bakr passed by, as a young man, he passed by a drunkard on the street. And the drunkard was acting in a, you know, manner that drunkards act, and he had put his hand in defecation on the street. And his hand was full of this, and he's waving it in the air, and you know, the disgusting thing is coming from his hand. And Abu Bakr felt such disgust at this that from that time on, even though he was a young man, he said, I don't want to drink khamr. And wallahi, this is so true. Those amongst us who, you know, have never drank khamr, and yet we look at the people, wonder, what would be the pleasure that you would want to act like this? Why would you want to put yourself in that situation? And this is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq as well. That he's just looked at the reality of alcohol and he says, I don't want to act like this. And so he made khamr haram on himself. And once he was giving a talk to the Sahaba after the death of the Prophet ﷺ in his Khilafah, and he mentioned something about himself, and he said in that sermon that I have never prostrated to an idol in my life. So he's telling about his own autobiography. I never prostrated to an idol. And he told the story that when I came of age, my father took me to the temple in Mecca, the idol temple. And he told me, these are your gods, you must worship them. and he left me with them. So Abu Bakr said, I went to one of these idols and said, I am hungry, feed me. But the idol didn't do anything. So I went to another, I said, I want clothes, give me food, give me clothes. The idol didn't do anything. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu realized that this is ridiculous. He in fact took a stone and smacked the idol, and the idol basically fell down. Abu Bakr said, I would never worship an idol in my life. So this story is of course reminiscent of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, that simply looking at the idols, you know this is batil. It's not going to be effective. And so Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, even before the coming of Islam, did not ever bow his head down to prostrate to an idol. And this shows us the purity of the fitrah of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And of course, he was also known throughout his life as being a very gentle, soft-hearted, soft-spoken person. And because of this, of course, he was beloved amongst the people of the Quraysh. Always people of a gentle nature become beloved. Always the modest, the meek, the humble people, they are the ones who are the most beloved in the community. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was indeed like that. And in the famous narration, we'll come to this inshallah next week, when, excuse me, when the Banu Taym, his sub-tribe, withdrew the protection, you know, when the persecution began, boycott began, so they withdrew the protection, and Abu Bakr was about to migrate to Abyssinia as well. Abu Bakr was about to migrate to Abyssinia because his own tribe and his own father took away their protection. So he was going to go. As we said many times, if you don't have protection, you don't have a visa. It's like your visa is gone, you cannot live there anymore. So when he's about to leave, one of the other chieftains of the people of Mecca, Ibn Daghina, said, O Abu Bakr, you cannot leave us. You cannot leave us. You are the ones who is good to his relatives and takes care of the orphan and feeds the poor and helps the one in distress. Now, these phrases, you've heard them before. Who said them to whom? Khadija said very similar phrases about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Ibn Hajar comments on this, and he says, it is amazing that two different people, Khadija and Ibn Daghina, said the same thing about two different people, Abu Bakr and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, without having agreed or met. And the description is of two different people, which demonstrates that the both of their similarities and characteristics and akhlaq overlap with one another. You see the point here? That the same descriptions that Khadija gave of the Prophet ﷺ, pretty much those phrases in slight different wording and whatnot, are found in Abu Bakr. That Ibn Daghina says, you are nice to your relatives, you take care of the poor, you feed the orphan, you shelter, and you help all of the people who need help. This is exactly what Khadija said of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this shows us the overlapping natures of the two people, the Prophet and Abu Bakr. And of course, the Prophet was obviously much more in this regard than Abu Bakr, but still there is some overlap. Also, as a young man, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, growing up, and being a young man, he was engaged in trade, and he took multiple trips to Rome, not to Rome, excuse me, the Roman Empire, not Rome, to the city of Basra, the city of Basra, which is outside of Damascus. And so multiple times he went there, and he amassed a good amount of wealth. Ibn Sa'd, the famous historian in his Tabaqat, he says, when Abu Bakr embraced Islam, he owned 40,000 dirhams. He owned 40,000 dirhams. So this would make him what we would call middle class. He's not wealthy and he's not poor. 40,000 dirhams. Then when he embraced Islam, then he became busy with that. And so he didn't earn the types of money that he used to. So embracing Islam, you can say he's of a middle class background, socio-economically. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is known for two titles that were given to him. The first is Al-Atiq, and the second is As-Siddiq. And there are others as well we'll talk about, but these are the two famous ones. That of the titles of Abu Bakr is Al-Atiq, and of his titles of course is As-Siddiq. As for Al-Atiq, there are a number of opinions about who gave him this title. One opinion is that his mother gave him this title. Why? Because she had two children before Abu Bakr and they both died. And so when Abu Bakr survived, so Atiq means the one who is freed. Atiq means the one who is freed. Ataqa is to free. So Atiq, the one who is freed. So when Abu Bakr survived, he was freed from death. So she gave him, "You're the freed one. Allah saved you from death." Or others, Atiq also means the old or the first. And so one opinion is that he was called Atiq because he was always the first to do some good. So there's another opinion. So this would mean that he was called Al-Atiq in the days of Jahiliyyah. The other opinion is that it was the Prophet Muhammad who gave him the title Al-Atiq in Islam. And this has its basis in some ahadith. In one hadith in Mustadrak al-Hakim and the Sunan Abi bin Mansur with the sanad fihi da'af, it is said that Aisha was sitting in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr came to visit, and the Prophet said, "Whoever wants to see Al-Atiq min an-nar, let him look at this person." Al-Atiq min an-nar, the one who's saved from Jahannam. Now this hadith is slightly weak, but there's an authentic hadith in At-Tirmidhi that the Prophet ﷺ said to Abu Bakr, "Abshir, be happy and rejoice, because anta atiqullahi minan nar. You are atiqullah minan nar. You are the one whom Allah has saved from the fire." So another opinion, and this inshallah seems to be the good one, both opinions are correct. He was called al-atiq by his mother, but the reason was because he was saved from death. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "No, you're actually atiq from the fire of hell." So he upgraded the term atiq to mean the one freed from the fire and not just the one who was saved. So of the names that Abu Bakr was known as is al-atiq. But of course his most famous title is as-siddiq. So much so that when we say as-siddiq in Islam, the one person that our minds turn to automatically and immediately is Abu Bakr. So As-Siddiq is his primary title. And there are many narrations in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that mention As-Siddiq as being of the titles of Abu Bakr. Of course, the most authentic one, which is in Bukhari and also a version of it in Sahih Muslim, is that the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman were climbing the mountain of Uhud. And Uhud began to rumble and shake. And the Prophet ﷺ patted the mountain with his foot. And he said, "Uthbut Uhud, calm down Uhud. فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ نَبِيٌّ وَصِدِّيقٌ وَشَهِدَيْنِ For the only people on you right now are a Nabi and a Siddiq and two Shaheeds. So this is muttafaq alayh hadith, that the Prophet ﷺ is calling Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. An-Nabi, as-Siddiq, and as-Shahidain. So the Prophet ﷺ is calling Abu Bakr, he is a Siddiq. Now of course this is of the most authentic, but the story that is the most well known, and the story is found in the books of Sirah, so you know it goes down a little bit level, but nonetheless nothing wrong with narrating. It's the famous story. All of you are aware of this. We discussed this, mashallah, 3-4 years ago when we talked about this incident of the Isra wal Mi'raj, that when the Prophet ﷺ was told by Jibreel to announce Isra wal Mi'raj, he announced it in front of the Kaaba. Remember the story? And the people began to quiz him and they ridiculed him, and a man came, you know, running and said to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, some type of friend would have been, or an acquaintance or a neighbor, in order to cause Abu Bakr to doubt. So he says, "Do you know what your companion has just said?" And he said, "What?" So he said, "He's just said he's gone back from Jerusalem. He went to Jerusalem and came back in the same night." So the Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, "If he said this, then he has spoken the truth." If he said this, because I don't know who you are, I cannot trust you, but if he said it, he has spoken the truth. فَقَدْ صَدَقْ So this man said, "Will you believe him?" أَتُصَدِّقُهُ صَدَّقَ means to believe. "Will you believe him? And he claims to have gone to Jerusalem and come back in one night." And the Prophet, Abu Bakr said, "Usaddiquhu, I believe him in something even more incredulous or amazing than this. I believe him when he says that wahi comes to him from the heavens morning and evening." So what's the big deal if I believe he comes from Jerusalem and back, right? So after this incident, it is said in the books of Sirah that he was called As-Siddiq. And of course, this is also a valid story that we can use to talk about the issue of As-Siddiq. And there are other as well narrations that mention this title or this description of Abu Bakr, and of them is a very, very beautiful hadith narrated in Sahih Muslim, that it is said that once the Prophet was sitting in the majlis, in the gathering in his masjid, and Abu Bakr came rushing into the masjid with his izar raised up, and there is a look on his face. And the Prophet ﷺ looked at Abu Bakr and said, Inna sahibakum qad ghamar. Your friend, meaning, that's how the Arabs would say, Inna sahibakum means your friend here, your companion, seems to have had an argument now. So clearly you could see the tension in the face of Abu Bakr. When Abu Bakr as-Siddiq came to the gathering, he greeted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, something happened between me and Umar ibn al-Khattab, and my soul got the better of me. Meaning I couldn't control my tongue. Meaning I said things that I shouldn't have said. Then I regretted it. So I asked him to forgive me, but he refused to forgive me. So I came immediately to you. Meaning to act as an intermediary, right? So he comes to the Prophet ﷺ and tells him the story. So the Prophet ﷺ said, غفر الله لك يا أبا بكر غفر الله لك يا أبا بكر غفر الله لك يا أبا بكر. Means you don't have to come to me. Allah has forgiven you, Abu Bakr. Allah has forgiven you. Allah has forgiven you. This is amazing, because without even listening to the side of Umar, you don't need to in this case. Abu Bakr, whatever he has done, Allah has forgiven him. غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ غَفَرَ three times. غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ. So Abu Bakr sat down. In the meantime, Umar radiallahu anhu, his temper calmed down. And he began to regret. What did he regret? That I should have forgiven. I shouldn't have been so hot-tempered that Abu Bakr is asking and telling me I'm sorry, and I say I'm not going to forgive you. He said he's sorry. So Umar ibn al-Khattab went to the house of Abu Bakr, knocked on the door. He's not there right now. So Umar ibn al-Khattab thinks he must be in the masjid. So he goes to the masjid, and lo and behold, there is Abu Bakr, there is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And so Umar ibn al-Khattab says salam, and the Prophet sallallahu's face is clearly irritated with Umar. And Umar sits down terrified, and his face still remains angry with Umar. And Abu Bakr, sensing the tension, gets up on his knees, like, you know, you stand up like this. And he says, as he's feeling pity for Umar, he feels sorry for Umar, that this, you know, he wants to now basically make shafa'ah for Umar after he came complaining about Umar, right? So he says, Ya Rasulullah, I was the one who was the more in the error of the two. Meaning I said things I shouldn't have said, right? Now, before I get to the end of this hadith, how amazing is this hadith? Wallahi, how beautiful is this? How many benefits you can extract? Of the simplest benefits is the Sahaba are human beings. And even if you're Abu Bakr and Umar, you're going to have words between you. Even if you're Abu Bakr and Umar, you're going to have issues. Even though they were the best of friends. They were the best of friends. And we just mentioned last week, Umar ibn Khattab said, how could I possibly be the leader of a qawm in which Abu Bakr is? And he was the one who picked up the hand of Abu Bakr and said, there can be no leader other than Abu Bakr. So they are the best of friends. But still, even in the best of friends, you're going to get some kalam, some back and forth. So the both of them got a little bit tempered. But what is the role model that they demonstrate? The both of them calmed down immediately. And the both of them want to resolve the conflict, not continue the conflict. The Prophet ﷺ, Abu Bakr goes to the Prophet ﷺ to use him as shafa'ah. Umar goes to Abu Bakr's wife, then he goes to the Prophet ﷺ wanting to defuse the situation. And this is how they are role models. Not that they never fought, but that when they fought, they demonstrate such manners, the both of them. We also notice Abu Bakr's tenderness, that he feels sorry for Umar now. He feels sorry for Umar. So he actually tells the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, you know, I did more wrong. Yani ana azlam. He goes, I'm the one who did more. Even though, wallahi, we don't know the details, but we know for sure, even if Abu Bakr got tempered, he didn't do any dhulm. He didn't cross that type of red line. Maybe, little bit of harshness, but how could Abu Bakr be that harsh, right? Nonetheless, Umar's temper is also Umar's temper, and he refused to forgive Abu Bakr at that time, because I'm not going to forgive you, you have crossed the line. So now Abu Bakr is saying, trying to calm the Prophet ﷺ down, saying, Ya Rasulullah, I was the one who was the more guilty of the two. And at this, the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent me to you while Allah Azza wa Jal sent, in Allah qad arsalana ilaykum, Allah has sent me to you, meaning as a prophet, and all of you said, initially, he is lying, meaning the Prophet is lying. Only Abu Bakr said, he is speaking the truth, sadaq. So from this we get the point of Siddiq, right? All of you said, he is lying, initially. Only Abu Bakr said, he is speaking the truth. And it is Abu Bakr who has made me his partner with himself and his wealth, meaning his daughter and his money. He has made me like I am his complete family. No one amongst you. In another hadith he said, مَا نَفَعَنِي مَالٌ كَمَالِ أَبِي بَكْرٍ. Nobody's money has benefited me like the money of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. So he now is praising Abu Bakr so much. And then he said, فَهَلَّا تَارِكُمْ لِي صَاحِبِي. So why don't you leave my sahib alone? Why don't you leave my companion alone? He calls him my sahib. And he is speaking in direct reference to Umar ibn al-Khattab, who is the second sahib. But there is no comparison even between Abu Bakr and Umar. And so after this, nobody ever crossed paths with Abu Bakr in a negative manner. When the Prophet ﷺ said, leave my sahib alone, do not irritate him. After this, nobody irritated him till he died. Because this is the status that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq had. And in a similar version, the Prophet ﷺ said that there was not a single one of you who, when I invited him to Islam, hesitated at least a little, except for Abu Bakr. For when I invited him to Islam, he embraced without any hesitation. So nobody embraced Islam instantaneously like Abu Bakr. Everybody else, little bit of back and forth and arguing and convincing. Only Abu Bakr embraced Islam without a second's hesitation. So this therefore demonstrates why is he called As-Siddiq. Okay, so of his titles is Al-Atiq. Of his titles is As-Siddiq, and there are other titles that are not that well known. Al-Awwah, some of the early scholars say, Zuhri I think said Al-Awwah, and Al-Awwah means the one who is turning to Allah all the time. Also, according to one report, when Allah revealed, وَسَيُجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى وَسَيُجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى الَّذِي يُؤْتِ مَالَهُ يَتَزَكَّى. This is a reference to Abu Bakr, and the books of Tafsir mention this. So of his names is Al-Atqa, because Al-Atqa means the one with the most taqwa. And Allah revealed this verse for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. وَسَيُجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى. So one of his titles therefore by Allah's testimony is Al-Atqa. So he is the most muttaqi person after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Al-Atiq and As-Siddiq are the common and the well-known ones. And then Al-Awwah and Al-Atqa are also mentioned as well. The family of Abu Bakr. The family of Abu Bakr. We mentioned his mother, we mentioned his father. How about his wives and his children? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was married to four women over the course of his lifetime. And from these four women, he had a sum total of six children. Three sons and three daughters. So very simple. Six kids, half-half. Three sons and three daughters. And the first of his wives, whom he divorced in Jahiliyyah. So she was not his wife when Islam came. She was his wife in the days of Jahiliyyah, and then divorce took place. And as you all know, in those days, marriage and divorce was much more common than it is now. Even in early Islam, marriage and divorce was much more common. It was not the stigma that is attached now. So his first wife was Qutayla binti Abdul Uzza. And Qutayla most likely did not embrace Islam, but some people say she did, but there doesn't seem to be any reference to her embracing Islam. And from Qutayla, he had one son and one daughter. And these are the eldest children of Abu Bakr. The firstborn of Abu Bakr was Abdullah. Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr. This is his eldest son, Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr. And we mentioned him in the seerah. We mentioned him in the hijrah. We mentioned him when they were hiding in the cave, Ghari Thawr. Remember, Abdullah was the one who would report from the people of Makkah and come back. This is that Abdullah. Okay? So Abdullah, when the hijrah takes place, is, we don't know an exact age, but maybe 11, 12, 13, like a young lad. So he's old enough to know to keep a secret, to go to the cave, to come back. He's not just a kid, he's not a full man. So the elders are speaking and they think this kid doesn't know anything. You know how the elders, they speak, and if it's a, you know, if it's a 15-year-old kid, they'll think, oh, but if it's a 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, you know, there's an age where you kind of ignore. So Abdullah was of that age. So from this we can kind of derive maybe between 10 to 12, roughly, that he was when the hijrah takes place. Maybe a little bit more, but around this age. Definitely not more than 15, 16, because he wasn't a man. He wasn't like a full-fledged man when the hijrah takes place. So this is that Abdullah. And that Abdullah, by the way, that Abdullah, not much is mentioned about him in the books of Seerah. It appears, Allah knows best, that he didn't play that active of a role in early Islam, other than the Hijrah incident. It doesn't, there is no mention of him in Badr or Uhud. And to be honest, I am perplexed at this. I read quite a lot of stuff, as much as I could today, and there doesn't seem to be an explanation of this. He clearly embraced Islam. He migrated to Hijrah. He did the Hijrah. He was the one who brought Rumman, who is his stepmother. And we'll talk about her. Rumman is the mother of Aisha, along with Aisha and his sister, who is his sister, Asma. Right. So Asma and Abdullah are full. Right. So he's the one who brought them to Medina. Okay, as a young boy, he's going and he's taking them to Medina, and he lives in Medina. So clearly he's a Muslim, he's converted to Islam, but for some reason we don't seem to have a lot of mention of him. Allahu alam, what is the issue? Maybe there was some issue with him, personal or psychological or something. Allahu alam, there doesn't seem to be, or maybe even physical, you don't know. These things are not fully reported, but it is mentioned that he did participate in the Battle of At-Ta'if. And he was severely injured in the Battle of At-Ta'if, and that injury eventually led to his prolonged sickness and death. So he was sick for over 2 years after the Battle of At-Ta'if, and he died in the Khilafah of Abu Bakr. He died after the death of the Prophet ﷺ. Within a few weeks he died. So Abdullah passed away right after the Prophet ﷺ by a few weeks. And not much is mentioned about him in the books of history or seerah. Abdullah's younger sister immediately is Asma binti Abi Bakr. Okay, so Asma and Abdullah, their mother is Qutaylah. And Asma, of course, she has a very prominent role. And we will have an entire lecture about Asma binti Abi Bakr. Her title was Dhatu Nitaqain, the one of two belts. Because she was the one who tore her belt in two. She had that girdle and she tore it. One half she gets to the hijrah provisions, and the other half she uses to tie up her awrah. So this is Dhatu Nitaqain. Now we know that her mother did not embrace Islam for a very long period, because in Sahih Muslim we read that Asma binti Abi Bakr was in Medina when her mother came to visit Qutaylah. And initially she refused to accept gifts from her or to allow her into her own house, meet somewhere else, not in my house, thinking that it is not allowed for an idol worshipper to enter the house of a Muslim. Then Allah revealed in the Quran the famous verse of Umtahina, "La yanhaakum Allahu 'anil ladina lam yuqatilukum fid dini wa lam yukhrijukum min diyarikum an tabarruhum wa tuqsitu ilayhim inna Allah yuhibbul muqsitin." Allah is not stopping you from meeting with and being good with those of the non-Muslim pagans who are not fighting you. It's a double negative. Go ahead and meet them if they're nice and polite to you. So then she accepted her mother's gifts and allowed her to come into her house, which means up until late Medina, she was not a Muslim. And then there's no mention of her after that. So this is why the scholars differ. We really don't know. But the fact is that because nothing is mentioned, Allahu alam, there doesn't seem to be any indication that she actually embraced Islam. But in any case, Allah knows, maybe she did later on and nothing is mentioned. So Abu Bakr divorced her in the days of Jahiliyyah. The wife that he had when Islam came was Umm Ruman. And Umm Ruman bint Amir ibn Uwaymir was another lady from the Quraysh. And Umm Ruman was the mother also of a boy and a girl. So from the first wife, Abu Bakr has a boy and a girl. From the second wife, Abu Bakr has a boy and a girl. And this boy and girl are? Aisha and Abdul Rahman. Okay? Aisha and Abdul Rahman. And Umm Ruman passed away in the sixth year of the Hijrah. Therefore, the Prophet ﷺ prayed janazah over her as well. So, Umm Ruman passed away in Medina. In the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is of course when. So this is the Prophet's mother-in-law. She's already married to Aisha, and in that time, Umm Ruman passes away. And Umm Ruman is also mentioned in the incident of the slander. Remember that Aisha went and asked Umm Ruman's, you know, whatnot, and all of this is mentioned in the books of the Sirah. We talked about it in detail. And of course, Abdul Rahman is Aisha's full brother, and she was the one. Sorry, he was the one in the incident of the incident of farewell Hajj. He was the one who accompanied Aisha to Tan'im, Masjid Aisha, and took her back to Mecca to do another Umrah. So this is Abdul Rahman. And other things are mentioned about Abdul Rahman. Inshallah, we'll get to him when we get to him. So this is Abdullah and Asma. This is Aisha and Abdul Rahman. Now the third wife of Abu Bakr. Who can remind me of the third wife? We mentioned her twice at least in the seerah. Our note taker is not here today, but even if he were here, very good, excellent. But what's her name? At least you narrowed it down. The wife of Ja'far. Huh? Yes, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib. And her name is Asma bint Umays. Asma bint Umays is one of those most amazing ladies in the history of our religion. She was married to Ja'far ibn Abi Talib. Then Ja'far dies. When does Ja'far die? The Battle of Mu'tah. So she becomes a widow. And so Abu Bakr proposes for her. And so she marries Abu Bakr. So she has children from Ja'far. Okay. And these are, of course, the basically the Banu Hashim, the cousins of the Prophet once removed. So then she marries Abu Bakr. And from Abu Bakr, she has a son. And this son was born in Hajjatul Wada'. And his incident is the narration of much fiqh, because Asma gave birth to this boy while she is in Ihram on her way to Mecca. So from this we get the fiqh of pregnant ladies in Ihram, from this incident. Okay? And that's why she's mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim and others that Asma bint Umays gave birth to Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. Okay? To Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr in Hajjatul Wada'. Okay? And that was the only child born to Asma. And by the way, so then Abu Bakr dies, obviously. Asma is still a relatively young lady. Who then does she marry? Ali ibn Abi Talib. So she was the only lady to be married to two Khalifas. And from both of them she had children. And from Ja'far she had children. So she has children from Ja'far. She has children from Abu Bakr. She has children from Ali. And the interesting thing, when Ali marries her, Muhammad is 4 or 5 years old. So Muhammad grows up in the household of Ali radiallahu anhu as a basically stepson, but as a you know, so Ali and Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr had a very strong bond together. Now you understand why I'm saying this.
Yes, exactly.
Guys, you don't understand. Okay, so there are tensions that some groups have between Ali and Abu Bakr. They say there were tensions. Do we believe there were tensions? No. There are a million and one evidences, but of the simplest evidences, Ali marries the widow of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And the child of Abu Bakr is raised like his own son. How could he have anything against Abu Bakr when he's marrying her and Muhammad, Abu Bakr's son, is being raised in his household like a son? Then when Muhammad becomes an adult, a fully male, Ali appoints him the governor of Egypt. How could he have anything against Abu Bakr? Think about it, right? I mean, it's so, and by the way, this is one of millions of things that, if you look at history, it is wallahi impossible to construct that Ali radiallahu anhu had problems with Abu Bakr and Umar. This is complete, you know, I mean, Umar ibn al-Khattab marries Ali's daughter. Umar ibn al-Khattab marries Ali's daughter. Ali becomes the father-in-law. Umar proposes to the daughter of Ali, Umm Kulthum binti Ali. And Ali gives his daughter in marriage. Now you tell me, how could there be any animosity? Do you give your daughter to somebody whom you think is an enemy of Allah and His Messenger? So this is, you know, as I said, later understandings. Early Islam, this is simply, it's impossible to hold this this view. So anyway, back to my story. Oh, by the way, this person, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, there is some controversy surrounding him, and that's one of the reasons why I don't want to go into all of these details, because these stories sometimes harm more than benefit. It is said, I'll just mention this tidbit because inshallah it is not true. It is said, some allege that he participated with the mobs against Uthman radiallahu anhu. But other books such as As-Suyuti, the historian, As-Suyuti mentions that, and others before him also mentioned that, when Uthman saw Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr in his house, he said to Muhammad, if your father were here right now, he would be very angry with you, or he would be very, you know, disappointed in what you're doing. You know, so Uthman said this according to one report. And so when he said this, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr felt so bad, he left. And then the rest of the people did what they did. So there are, again, this is one of the reasons, by the way, that we really don't like talking too much. I just want to give you this tidbit to give you an example. And this is one of the minor issues. There are much more difficult issues with much more respected Sahaba, because in the end of the day, and I say this as explicitly as possible, the Sahaba are humans. And their ijtihad is not like the ijtihad of the Prophet. Yes, the Prophet is also human, but his ijtihad is sanctioned by Allah. We have to defend the Prophet 100%, everything he said and did. Religiously, we have to. We cannot find one fault with him. If anybody were to find fault with Rasul, that person is not a Muslim. Very explicit here. Anybody criticizes Rasulullah, disagrees with something, that person is not a Muslim. But the Sahaba is a different story. We are not allowed to criticize their sincerity, their love for Islam. But we do not have to agree with each and every interpretation or statement or incident, or especially political decision. Clear? And that, of course, is a very fine line, because when you start questioning decisions, it's very easy to jump over and question their intentions, which is what the other group does. Whereas for us, we say the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ, they had the right intentions, but maybe they made some mistakes. Maybe their temper got the better of them. Maybe some issue happened that wasn't the wisest, but we don't question their overall commitment to Allah and His Messenger, their overall sincerity to Allah and His Messenger. And of course, Muhammad, by the way, Ibn Abi Bakr, is he a Sahabi? Well, depends. There is a category of Sahaba that are basically baby Sahaba. Because Muhammad Ibn Abi Bakr himself never saw the Prophet ﷺ. Because he was 1 year old, 1.5 year old, when the Prophet ﷺ passes away. So he is not quite a Sahabi, yet he is a Sahabi. There's a Mukhadram, there's a category, there's a special category that is given to them. And this category is basically the children, and the children meaning, you know, like not 7, 8 years old. If you're 7, 8 years old and you saw the Prophet, you're a Sahabi. If you remember seeing the Prophet, you're a Sahabi. Okay. Otherwise, Hassan and Hussein are Sahaba, but they were still not baligh. But Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, he has no recollection of the Prophet. So he is a category, we call them mukhadram, that you're not quite the full Sahabi, you're not quite the tabi'i. So most people say he's the highest level of the tabi'un. And this is the correct position. That the mukhadramun are the highest level of the tabi'un. That the Prophet ﷺ saw them, but they did not recall seeing the Prophet ﷺ. Clear, I go into a tangent here, not really relevant. But anyway, so which number are we on now? Asma binti Umays we've done. Now we get to four, that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq after the death of Ummi Ruman, so he married Asma and he also married eventually another lady. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq never had four ladies at once. He had one and then one and then one and then one, one and then two. So basically towards the end of his life he had two wives. And the fourth and the final of his wife and the only of his non-Qurashi wives, the other three are all Qurashiya, they're all, other three are all from Mecca. The only wife of his from Medina was Habiba binti Kharija from Al-Ansariya. She was Al-Ansariya, the only one, Habiba, was from the Ansar and he married her in Medina. And this was the wife that he was with when the Prophet ﷺ passed away. Remember, in the morning the Prophet ﷺ appeared to be better on the Fajr of the Monday. And Abu Bakr, everybody thought he's much better now. So he had been camping in the masjid for a week, as we said. He had been camping in the masjid. And so he asked permission for the Prophet ﷺ that, Ya Rasulullah, can I now go visit, Bint Habiba, can I go and visit, this is the Bint Kharija, excuse me, Habiba Bint Kharija, can I go visit Bint Kharija? And so he gave permission to go. And so the news of the Prophet ﷺ death came when he was in the house of Habiba Bint Kharija, and her house was also in the district of Medina called Awali. And I always like mentioning this because we lived in Awali at the time and when we lived in Medina. So Abu Bakr's house of Habiba was in Al-Awali. And Abu Bakr on his deathbed said to Aisha, radiallahu anha, he said to Aisha, O Aisha, I command you, my wasiyah to you is to take care of your two younger brothers and your two younger sisters. So Aisha said, I only have one sister. Who's the other sister? And Abu Bakr said, Habiba is pregnant. Aisha did not know that. Habiba is pregnant. And I have a premonition that she will give birth to us girl. And that's exactly what happened. That after the death of Abu Bakr, Habiba bint Kharija gave birth to a girl. So this girl was born when Abu Bakr had died. And this girl was called Kulthum. And so this Kulthum is the sixth and the final child of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So once again, let's go over this together. From Qutayla he had, who did he have from the first wife? Abdullah and Asma. Then from Ruman he had Aisha and Abdurrahman. Then from Asma bint Umays he had Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. And then from Habiba bint Kharija he had Kulthum. These are a total of six. And subhanAllah, time flies so fast, mashaAllah. So we have to finish here, but one interesting point that we conclude. Of the interesting points is that Abu Bakr's family is the only family that we know of that embraced Islam from Mecca in its entirety without a single non-Muslim. Abu Bakr's mother, Abu Bakr's father, Abu Bakr's wife at the time when Islam came, and of course his future wives, and all of Abu Bakr's children. There's no other Sahabi who can claim this. At least one person, either the mother, the father, something. Go and look it up. Umar ibn al-Khattab, Uthman, all have one or two. So, Abu Bakr's family is a family of Iman. It's not just Abu Bakr. The whole family is a family of Iman. Everybody embraced Islam in the immediate family without any exception. And this is only for the case of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Also of the peculiarities of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is that in his family is the only person who is Sahabi for four generations. There is no Sahabi who is Sahabi, the son of the Sahabi, the son of the Sahabi, the son of the Sahabi, other than somebody from the family of Abu Bakr. And this is Who? Who is this? I haven't mentioned him by now. I have not mentioned him by now. Who? Excellent, mashallah. Our sister gets it right. Give the nasab, give the lineage. So how is he the Sahabi son of Sahabi son of Sahabi son? Abdullah ibn Zubayr, you're right. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, the son of? Well, we're going the wrong lineage now from here. The son of Asma, from the mother's side, right? The son of Abu Bakr, sorry, the daughter of Abu Bakr, the son of Abu Quhafa. So all four are Sahaba, right? So this is a quiz question. Who is that Sahabi that has four Sahaba in the lineage? One after the other, all of them are Sahaba. And that is Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Okay? Because Abdullah ibn Zubayr, his grandfather is Abu Bakr from his mother's side. So his mother is Asma. So he is a Sahabi. She is. When was Abdullah ibn Zubayr born? Has another story. As soon as Asma arrived in Medina, the first baby born, even before Quba was built, or the masjid of the Prophet is built, and the Muslims rejoiced at his birth because they took it as a good omen. Remember, we're allowed to believe, we're supposed to believe in good omens. And because the Quraysh had predicted that if you leave us, Allah will not give you any children. And so the day they arrive in Medina, Allah blesses them with a child. And that child is the grandson of Abu Bakr through his daughter Asma. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr, the son of Asma, Asma is the daughter of Abu Bakr, Abu Bakr is the son of Abu Quhafa. These are the four generations. As for Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, of course, he is only three generations, so he does not count. Plus, Muhammad is a Mukhadram, so it doesn't count. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr is the only one with that. SubhanAllah, so much more to say. Anyway, we'll start next Wednesday, inshallah, with the story of the Islam of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And of course, all of you know, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the first convert to Islam outside of the immediate family members of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Khadija converted, perhaps Ali as a young boy converted, Zayd converted, Abu Bakr converted. There's a big controversy in the tartib of converts, but in the end of the day, within the span of a few days, all of these people converted. And the first to convert as an adult male of his own free will and volition, because Ali is a child, and Zayd is the adopted son, as you know at the time, and Khadija, as you know, the wife of the story. So the first person to whom Islam is presented, and he has really the full luxury to say yes and no, and he immediately says yes, is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And that will be the story we begin with, inshallah ta'ala, next Wednesday. Final point, inshallah, with the change of the time of Maghrib, let's inshallah try to pray Maghrib in the masjid, and as the time proceeds, we might have to delay a few weeks and just start with the beginning of Salat al-Maghrib. And a fiqh benefit, and I mentioned this before, that while technically it is allowed to have another jama'ah, the correct opinion is that it is ja'iz to have another jama'ah when you miss the jama'ah, but in some cases it does become makruh, and of those cases is when there is knowledge or an ilm going on, because the second jama'ah is not more important than the scheduled, if you like, or the regular dars. In fact, some madhahib, as you know, say there should not be a second jama'ah. You know this, right? Some madhahib are strict in this regard, but the correct opinion is that it is permissible. But when there is a clash, obviously, then in this case, the one jama'ah should suffice, and this should go on. And the reason I say this is because we have to delay. If there's a jama'ah going on, then we have to delay, and then it causes us a delay right now. So inshallah, next week, those who come late, if they can just... but inshallah, next week you should come on time.
So late comer can pray individually?
Individually. You can pray individually, inshallah. Yeah, just go individually, anywhere. Just pray, inshallah. Any quick questions about the material for today, before you move on to... Yes?
Abu Bakr, does he have any brothers and sisters?
Abu Bakr has half brothers and sisters, not full. and none of them are playing a major role. But full brothers and sisters, no. No full brothers and sisters.
The word Sahaba is reserved to those lucky people who actually saw and spent time with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu
alaihi wasallam. The word Sahaba is used for those who accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you say saw, what if he was blind? Such as Ibn Umm Maktum. So the word Sahabi, there is a big controversy in early Islam about what is the definition of a Sahabi. And there are over 10 opinions. And what later Sunni scholars have basically all agreed to, there was a controversy in very early Islam. Why? Because this is an academic point, and again, sometimes knowledge is not that beneficial, sometimes it's actually harmful, but inshallah, this is not harmful. Think about the Bedouin who urinated in the masjid. He's also a Sahabi technically. So when we as innocent Muslims say the word Sahabi, we honestly think of Abu Bakr and Umar. That's it. But we forget the fact that over 100,000 people saw the Prophet ﷺ in his life. And the bulk of them were not like Abu Bakr and Umar. The people who called out from behind the house of the Prophet ﷺ, that come out and meet us, and Allah reveals Surah Al-Hujurat. They are Muslims and they are Sahabi. They're not kafir, they're not munafiq, they're Sahabi, but they're crude in their mannerisms. So many of the early scholars were hesitant to call that group Sahaba. And they said, for example, one opinion is a Sahabi is only those who participated in the Ghazwa with the Prophet. That's an early definition. Or a Sahabi is one who accompanied the Prophet for a period of time. Because these delegates, they came and they met him for 10 minutes and that's it. The Bedouin urinates, he meets him, he goes away. That's not accompanying, that's visiting. So some early scholars said you have to live with the Prophet, you know, a few weeks, a few months, like that. But as time goes on, human nature is to basically, you know, make things easier and bigger and grandiose. And so later scholars said, khalas, anybody who ever saw the Prophet gets to the status of a Sahabi. And this is what is basically the unanimous consensus of later Sunni scholars. So anybody who accompanied the Prophet as a Muslim, that's another condition. Because if you accompanied him as a non-Muslim, well then, that doesn't make you a Sahabi. And so there are some unique and bizarre situations where some people do not remember accompanying the Prophet, such as Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, they're called Mukhadramun. Some people, very few, saw the Prophet as a non-Muslim and later embraced Islam. And these are not Sahaba. And of the examples is the Tanukhi. Remember the Tanukhi guy? Yeah. The guy who came as the emissary from? Yemen. Emissary from? Not Yemen.
From
Hercules, from the Caesar. Right? The Tanukhi guy, when the Prophet said, accept Islam, he said, I am right now an ambassador. I cannot do anything right. I'm not going to accept Islam. Later on, he embraced Islam. So he is one of those very rare people who saw the Prophet, but he's not considered a Sahabi. And there are also people who saw the Prophet. There's one person we know for sure. He came to Medina to basically become a Sahabi, and the Prophet passed away, and he arrived Monday. So he prayed the janazah. So he saw the body of the Prophet ﷺ, but we don't consider him Sahabi. So there are some interesting areas there, but that answers your question, inshallah. You had a question?
So you mentioned that about the character of the Prophet ﷺ, that he had said something, and about the character of Abu Bakr, I forget the name of the person. But
Ibn al-Daghina, yes.
So they had a very similar
mm-hmm.
Yet, the Prophet ﷺ said that if there was a prophet after me, it would be Umar. So that just got me thinking, what was the difference in character that he would say something like that about Umar, even though Abu Bakr's character was most similar to his own?
I don't understand the question. What was the difference in character between Abu Bakr and Umar? So each one has certain blessings that the other does not have. And each one has certain characteristics that the other does not have. In one hadith, which is a little bit disputed, the Prophet ﷺ said to Abu Bakr that you are the closest of my ummah to Ibrahim. And he said to Umar, you are the closest of my ummah to Musa. Now if you know Ibrahim and Musa, and the difference is between them, you kind of get Abu Bakr and Umar, right? And who is the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ more similar to, Ibrahim or Musa? Ibrahim. Okay. So it's not as if when you have one blessing here, there's no blessing there. Each one has his own blessings. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the closest in his akhlaq to the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Okay, inshallah, with that we will stop for today and continue next Wednesday, inshallah ta'ala.